Park. There is a launch of the SA National Parks Week, and we hand over to you right now. It's over to you, Valen. Thank you so much for watching. Till next time then, goodbye from Johannesburg.
Simpiwe, thank you so much. And I think that as we conclude our outside broadcast from Maserini Hill, it'll only be appropriate that we chatted to our host for the morning from the Kruger National Park. Now, the Kruger National Park is one of the largest game reserves in Africa. It covers an area of 19,485 square kilometres. The park has 9 main gates allowing entrance to the different camps, and all the big 5 game animals are found at Kruger National Park, which has more species of large mammals than any other African game reserve. That's 147 species. So you can imagine managing this massive park is no easy feat. To find out more, I'm joined by Glen Phillips, who's the managing executive of the Kruger National Park. Good morning and welcome to Morning Live.
Thank you. Good morning, Valen, and good morning to the viewers.
We've been here the entire morning at Maserini Hill, which is rich in cultural heritage. How do you manage that balance between tourism and people getting up close and personal with the big 5, but then also preserving our cultural heritage and the natural biodiversity?
Well, firstly, it's a team effort. I have over 2,000 staff members that make it happen every day throughout the park. And as you correctly mentioned forward, it's a huge, huge park. It's 2 million hectares in size. That's the size of Israel. As a comparison, so we're running a country in terms of size now. It does come down to the people that have to make it happen, and the balance between our conservation mandate, which is our core mandate, and looking after this incredible natural heritage we have, but also the cultural heritage which you've seen today. But then, of course, all the big and hairies, all the animals that the people come and see, the bird life. But we've got to keep a balance, because we can't manage for one species, we manage a system. And whilst it's very easy to fall in love with the big 5 and to love the big 5 and want to see the big 5, there's so much more than that. And it's through our science work, the members of the scientific team, the member of the conservation team, our rangers on the ground, that ensure that we manage the landscape and keep it as intact as possible.
How many people can you have actually coming into the park on a daily basis?
We try and balance it around the school holidays. So when we've got a busy period, we allow a few more through the gates during busy periods. We have to manage differently on those days. We host 1.9 million visitors a year through the park. So it depends on which gate. So we limited number of vehicles per gate. So it's, we don't have a total number. And we balance it between entries and exits during the day. So we try and manage it around that. We've made certain decisions on the new park management plan, which we've just completed now for the next 10 years, where we won't be doing further bed development south of the Sabi River, accommodation development, other than what's in the plan now, so the new Skukuza Lodge, which is almost complete now, as well as a train experience, the old Salati Railway carriage experience on the Salati Bridge at Skukuza. And that's it. We're no more bed development, because we feel we've reached saturation point in terms of vehicle capacity, particularly, and human capacity in the south, and our developments now, if we do it, will be peripheral and further north in the park.
Where can people find out about this new plan that you guys have over the next 10 years and what the plans are for the Kruger National Park? Some people have been coming here for years and years and years. They want to know exactly how it's going to change, if at all.
Sure. So if you go to the Sand Park's website and under the Park Management Plan section, you'll be able to find the draft plan. The plan is sitting with the Minister for final sign-off. It's gone through all the technical reviews and that's passed all that. We had a very extensive stakeholder process in terms of putting it together. We had 53 meetings around the country with various stakeholders. Incredible input. And from a conservation perspective, people must be comfortable and happy that that is our core mandate, and that is what we have to keep intact, because without conservation we won't have tourism, we won't have the cultural heritage. We've got to look after those things, because that's what the attraction is. So that will stay intact. In terms of the footprint of development in the park, the current footprint is 0.69% is the footprint of development of the whole park. So it's a very small percentage of the park is developed, and we want to keep it that way. There are tracts in the north of the park here where you can get lost in there and not get found. The areas are so big. So people can be very comfortable. The conservation element is taken care of. There's no doubt about that. That's our core mandate. And we have to be responsible in how we develop and how we make sure we generate revenue to fund our conservation mandate, because it is a black hole when it comes to funding, and that's what the plan's all about. The other key element of the plan is how we integrate with our partners. We're not an island, and it's integrating with our partners which is key.
How are you guys doing when it comes to fighting the scourge of poaching, not only of our rhinos, but also of our ellies?
I can tell you now that we are winning the battle slowly but surely. Our numbers of rhino poached are down every year now, so we're winning the battle. Unfortunately, the syndicates behind it will find other ways getting poaching done. So they are shifting a bit to the elephant poaching, which is in the north of the park, right in the north of the park between Zimbabwe and South Africa and Mozambique. The plan we've had for rhino poaching, we're applying to that as well. But it does mean our resources are being tapped even more so. So an indication, in 2011, my ranger services budget was 50 million rand a year. This year it's 270 million rand a year. So the increase is exponential, but we don't have a choice. We can't say that our budget is now expended and we can't fly or we can't send our rangers out. So we have to respond no matter what. And we are getting on top of it. And that is through the use of various technologies which we're applying, some of it becoming very successful, which is preventing the poaching in the first place. I think the key issue is pointless responding to a shot or after the animal shot. We have to get to them before the animal is shot. And our technology that we're applying now is starting to deliver that. But at the end of the day, it also comes down to communities. We are surrounded by 2 million people on the western boundary of the park. A lot of people are unemployed and in poverty, and that is ripe ground for syndicates to come in and to recruit people who want quick money. And unfortunately, it is young people that are being recruited into these areas, but they're not going to win. And unfortunately, we do call on communities, please play your role with those people. Comes other criminality, not just poaching. And we're seeing it. The communities are telling us criminality is increasing in the areas, and it's because of these syndicates moving in.
Absolutely, but then we've also got the international community helping with China banning the sale or the import of ivory, which is great news for us, and Hong Kong coming on board after 2020. Mr. Glen Phillips, thank you very much for chatting to us, and thank you for being our host for the entire Morning Live team.
It's been an absolute pleasure, and please visit your parks, learn to love them. They're there for a long time, and they're for our children. So come and learn what it's all about. Thank you very much.
And that's the best way to conclude our broadcast, which we've been bringing you specially to launch the 2018 South African National Parks Week. South African citizens, you've got free access to most of the national parks around South Africa. So go out and enjoy it. Until we meet again on tomorrow morning's program, from inside our studio, from myself, Aileen Kirtley, and the rest of the Morning Live team from Masurini Hill in the north of the Kruger National Park, goodbye and have a great Monday.